for me, I don't know if you want to make sense of how powerful it is, like, you know, you're going to be the power of the home. And growing up, like, you know, growing up in a home, I really did feel like I was lost away. And I longed for those, but I never left. I did. So I would be, as a young song there, and a couple years ago, she wrote a song called Lost Boys, and she says that she says, I've never met as home for lost boys that grieve, lost boys that feel free. And even as a child, I knew I was lost. I knew that I wasn't free. I knew that my reality wasn't home, and I was yearning for something more than where I was. I knew that. So if I think about things, I really find myself growing up. I have two problems in my prayer. There are two things that I find myself growing up. One thing I wanted before I gave my life to Christ, before I came home, but the other thing that I wanted to pray after. Okay? So the first thing that I find is I've always wanted to be the son of a father. I've always wanted to be a kid. So that's many things in my life as I alluded to. I would just dream to just kind of look for ways that I could form something that I felt tied around every man in his life as a dad. And it comes out really fit because I wanted to be that so bad. And God is good and God is kind of my attention. When I came to Jesus, it was a very first thing he could do. He was a 19-year-old at UGM in Watsonville, California, on a softball field. I answered the altar call. I heard the name of God who was God said, which one? He was looking for a father. So, correctly after that, the things that I knew that I wanted, I wanted a heart that beat like a heart of power.
Yes.
I wanted that. And I'm still in the process of doing that. But the thing that's just beautiful and hilarious almost to me is the amount of times that I've been caught out of the word of having a solid heart that I've had to be in the time anymore. I don't know the problems of everything. This happened this weekend. We were at a Tahoe, and we actually were back along some of the family camp. And on the platform service, we don't really know any people in this church. We service it, and we said, there's a speaker, and he comes out to be a field service. And so, he comes out to be a field service, and he says, I'm swung from the stage, and I was hoping I'd get a chance to talk to you. I just want you to know, because I want to say, tell you. So this is what I am. This is what I am. This is why I don't want to be. I want to be a son.
Yes.
It's a part of the father. That's your family. That's your one. And so to think about speaking and sharing on the day today. To think about speaking about the election, is it marvel? Is it marvel? Is it miracle? And I would say that it's a pure fire right now. But the Father still brings lost boys home. So, the whole series that we've been calling the Father Complex and has been great about. What we really need to go after this season really felt like a battle singling out the orphan spirit among us. And so, if you're here today and you are an orphan in the spirit, you have not given your life to Jesus, or you have given your life to Jesus, you are a child of God positionally, but you are an unhealed orphan experientially. The Father in heaven is your highest spirit to heal you today. I'm excited about that. We're going to take some time to help you with that here at the Jesus Church. And Dr. John talked about how Jesus' primary goal was to reveal the Father. Jesus, more than anyone in history, called God the Father. He's the first one to ever address God the Father. And think about this. Every single time Jesus talked and spoke to God, except one time, every time. Thank you.
opposite from force or energy. God is not like a man's son from suggestion. That's how he faces him. And then he chose to be in the hand, he was not in another suggestion. Miles away, I was trying to think of the same things for the man always in the presentation. He asked for further. So it's exactly her decision. He didn't make it up to a Baptist church. But that was going to remind him of his roots. That was part of the going to try and train of his roots. That's the best you can do now. He's too proud of the man who calls up his office to get the truth now. And so he sleeps on the street. He's in concrete for Jesus. I mean, he's when he's been so cold. He lived so cold that he's young. He didn't come to the cross while that was cross back because he never keeps from cold. It's been 6 years, 20 days since he didn't come, but how did he get here anyway? This is how it was supposed to be. He's after the day before he chose to leave. Centuries, the story has been called the parable of the prodigal son. And I would submit to you that to think of this as a story only about a younger son would be a mistake. And so, what I'm going to do for the time that we have together, I'm going to show you that this is a story about much more than that. It's a story about separation. It's a story about sin, and it's a story about salvation. Okay? I'm going to show you guys that. And so, first I want to show you what it means to be separated from the Father. Now, when Jesus told this parable, it's never seen so terrible to read the Bible that you want to go into what you do for a second. But it's important when he tells a parable for you to consider the four teams. You've got to consider the context, you've got to consider the catalyst, you've got to consider the characters and the characters, you've got to consider the lesson that he's teaching. So we're talking about the character of limitations and the core lesson. But I want you to see the context. So Jesus came with four different types of people throughout his ministry. I can't even train them. I can train this down. But the four people that he came out with tax collectors, he came out with sinners, Jews, and the prophets, and scribes, and Pharisees. Right? And if you shrink that down even more, you can. He came out with the rebellious and the religious. And so, Jesus is taking out these four groups of people in Luke 15, and criticism comes as he tells his ministry over and over again about him hanging out with the sinners. And so, Jesus launches into the story. And so, that's the context of that. He's always not going to kind of defend himself for who he's going to be trying to win. Right? And so, the catalyst is that Jesus is trying to emphasize the character of his Father and his concern and care for the lost. He wants the religion to understand that they have their own brand of lawsuit that is not what's going on here. Right? They have their own brand of lawsuit. And so Jesus knows that it'll be the religious folks in the prophets. It'll be the religious folks, not the rebellious folks who are going to crucify him and kill him. Amen. Still, things are engaged. Okay? So Jesus tells the story of a young son who comes to his father and asks what he's saying. He says, Father, son. So the father, give me my share of the estate. Now, the original here, they have heard this, they would have been astounded. Right? They would have been astounded. This man had two sons in this culture. If the father died, all of his family would have died. Right? And he would have been divided two thirds to the older son and one third to the younger son. Okay? This is called a long private culture. And because you were a man, but you were a main economic engine in this culture, it was important to get as large as possible. It's important to maintain social stability and to preserve the wealth and power and social standing of your family. And so, the older son will get more right than the younger. But all that happened when the father died. That's what happened. And so when the son came, we asked the father for the cherubim to take him out. The original hearers were in amazed what commentators have been. Like it says, to ask for the inheritance while the father was still alive was sufficient and dead. The Bible background commentary says such a statement would not work well even today. In a society suggesting obedience to one's father, it would be a serious tactic of fighting for which the father could complete him or worse. So what the other side is saying here is, yeah, I want your stuff. I don't want you.
Wow.
I want my father's pain. I don't want my father. My relationship with you has been a means to an end, and I'm tired of it. I want my stuff now. That was your life. And so, if the hearers were made in such regards to me in the first row, they're even more made of God at the beginning rather than in the first row. Because it says the Father is fighting the property. This translation says property, but the Greek word translated property is actually the word title, the word of theology. And so, what it's really saying is that the Father is fighting his life. Again, we can understand this relationship because Adam was a great man in this culture. Because the father would have had to live with it, he would have to sell off part of his property in order to fulfill his son's request. Okay, everybody did it, he was bound up with your land. To lose your land was to lose yourself. And to lose part of your land was to lose his name in the community, which was tied to how much land you had. And so the son is asking for his father to tear his life apart. Your children's decisions are not always a reflection of your parents. The world is full of the Bible. I can tell you this. The Bible is full of good parents with good children, good parents with bad children, bad parents with good children, bad parents with bad children. So some of us have squandered everything we have, and we've literally become the blood in a big time, realizing how foolish we've been. And so he says, I will tell you. I'll go back to my father and tell him how foolish I've been. I'll go back, and he divides his plan. He's going to tell us, I know I'm no longer worthy to call him son. Make me a higher servant. Make me a higher servant. Now, the other son divides him down. The father takes him far off, and he runs. He runs after him. He runs towards him. The father shows us an absolute emotional abandon. He goes and gives it to the son. The son tries to roll out his restitution plan, but how does that happen? He doesn't want to hear it. He says, go get our girl, go get our ring, go get the sandals, go get the cat, not the heart. He says, what is offering his son this point? He's offering his son his robe, which is his righteousness, his loyalty, his identity, his position with the Lord. He's offering him his ring, which is his authority, his power. He's offering his son sandals, which are our practical means. He would say, that I want to give you all your comforts back. You're not a slave or a servant. You're not a slave or a servant. But you are my example of all the entitlements. He says, go there because of the fat calf, which is symbolic of sacrifice and sin. He says, it's your part of the salvation, which is symbolic of hell. The reason why I want to make sure we understand those things are because everything that the father gave his son in that moment is exactly what he did. It's exactly what he did. And so the father would say to his son, I'm not going to wait for you to clean up. I'm not going to wait for you to get yourself together. I'm certainly not going to wait for you to prove yourself. I'm bringing you back. I'm bringing you back to his son. And so when the older son gave his father, he's particularly upset about the calf. He's really upset about the calf. Like, in that context, that you almost never clean that meal, like, meat was a delicacy. And it was really, really expensive to have a fatted calf, something you would almost never do as a fatted calf. And so this had to be the biggest part in the child that was young. It has to be. And so when the older brother takes it, he says to his father, how dare you use your dog like this? I have obeyed you. Say, I will save it for you. flesh out and say, in other words, I got to write over your things. That's what I'm saying. He insults his father. He didn't address my father. He says, or tell his father, he says, look, you insult his father. Who do you upset? Like, some of you use multiple games, right? Two ways. If you take that living a good life, it's your ticket. begin living a good life, it's the way of salvation. And if you think that, man, I love people, I'm doing it, I'm praying, I'm being my Bible, right? If God has to bless me, then Jesus gave you a reward. Choose to be your inspiration to make you an example of Jesus, not your Savior. You are your own Savior. You're your Savior when I avoid sin. You try to control God by what you're doing, all your doubt, all your obedience, all of it. It's just a way of trying to get God to give you what you really want to do. Thank you. nothing I did. God initiated it. The Father initiated it. The Father considered it that he wants to do it. So we think about the word power meaning. But this is the definition of power. It's very natural in this world. It's really impressive. It means grace for the child. It means having or giving something from the past to God. And that's the judge of God.
Thank you.
Thank you.